This nation was founded on the principle that all men are created equal.
We hold these truths to be self-evident.
That all men are created equal.
I'll tell you what freedom is to me. No fear. I mean, really, no fear.
Isn't it equal?
This is Created Equal from WDET in Detroit. I'm Stephen Henderson, and I'm here in the studio with the show's producer, Carrie Jr. the second. Hey, Carrie.
Good morning.
Long night last night everybody.
It went late. It did. It's been a minute, so I was like, it's time to go to bed. I have to get up early. So.
This is also sooner in the cycle that we're dealing with presidential debates. Normally, they're in the fall. I can't remember the last time there was one in the middle of the summer before the conventions. I was kind of excited for the idea of it, but I don't know, within 5 minutes or so, I was a little distressed.
It definitely, what I said yesterday was a more of a spectacle. It wasn't really much of a spectacle, but I did feel like the viewers kind of left wanting for more from both candidates.
Yeah, so. I mean, it was not much of a debate, if you kind of use that word in literal terms. They definitely were going back and forth and going at each other, but there was very little substance, I think, that came out of their exchanges. We do want to talk about the debate today, though, here on Created Equal, and we want to sort of put a particular lens on the debate. There are two constituencies here in Southeast Michigan that are going to be really key to which way this state goes in the November elections. Of course, African-Americans, who are the majority of the voters in the city of Detroit, helped decide, really, the 2016 election for president, when 20,000 people who had voted in Detroit in 2012 did not show up to vote for Hillary Clinton in 2016. As a result, Donald Trump was able to win the state by a margin of about 10 or 11,000 votes. So, of course, Democrats this year are really focused on African-Americans and African-American turnout. We also here in Southeast Michigan, of course, have a wonderfully large Arab-American population. And their votes, of course, are always in contention between the two parties. This year in particular, people are really focused on what's happening in Israel with Gaza and the role that the administration, the Democratic administration, has been playing in that conflict. So we want to talk about last night's debate and, of course, the presidential race overall and how these two kind of key constituencies fit into the narrative. Of course, we also want to talk about Democratic participation, and that's one of our pillars here on Created Equal as well, the idea of getting more people engaged and involved in our politics. Debates are supposed to be one of the ways that we do that. I don't feel like last night was a great example of it. We're also going to want to hear from our listeners today. I'm sure most of them took a look, at least for a little bit, at the debate last night. What did you think of Donald Trump and all of the falsehoods that he repeated over and over again? Some of them were new last night. He came up with stuff that I hadn't heard him say before. And then what did you think of the president, 81-year-old Joe Biden? I don't know that he's ever seemed as much 81 as he did last night. And I say that as somebody who has a parent who is that age, and I'm not mocking or dismissing in any way. But there are things about the way that people that age can engage in things, can follow and focus, that really is noticeable. And it was terribly noticeable last night.
So before you get to your guest and introduce your guest, Stephen, I have a question for how you're going to approach your analysis of the debate last night.
Right.
Do you look at the candidate for specific substance and content, or I guess I say how much, because I think we look for a couple of things, the content and the presentation, right, of the candidate. How are they delivering their message? For you, which one holds more weight? Or is it equal to 50-50?
Well, I mean, I think for me personally, it's substance, right? I'm looking for not just the ability to answer questions, but an understanding of the kind of nuance and complications of policy questions. I mean, that's what I'm always looking for in candidates. And I think candidates who can reflect that in a debate setting, on a debate stage, are really impressive. But of course, you know, this isn't about that for, I think, most Americans. Most Americans don't have as much time to spend thinking about these things as we do in the press. And they're just kind of taking a look to see how well somebody can do under those circumstances. And so performance really matters quite a bit, even though I try to ignore it. Although last night, I have to say, the performances were everything. I mean, there wasn't much else, and you couldn't take your eyes off either of them because of the things that they were doing or not doing.
So that was definitely a glaring element. I'd say for me, substance, I think, is what I would like in an ideal debate. But for some time, with the short amount of time here in some of these, in the formats, I don't feel like I always get the substance I need. And a lot of the platform stuff I'm already familiar with. So I always look at the character, what's the vision they're setting out for the country, and how are they presenting that vision. But okay, we can get to your guests.
Yeah, we've got two great guests here. Karen Dumas is a PR and communications consultant, someone I've known for a long time and talked to frequently about politics. We also have Osama Siblani here. He is the publisher of the Arab American News and somebody who also has his finger on the pulse of what folks in our community are thinking about politics. So let's get to it. Karen Dumas and Osama Siblani, welcome to Created Equal.
Good morning.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's great to have both of you here. It's great to see both of your faces this morning. I mean, when I think about the number of people I could talk to about what happened last night, you two are at least among my favorites. And I'm very eager to hear what you have to say about what we saw. I do want to start with just the overall reaction to the debate and what people said and what we saw last night. I have never seen performances like this in a major, in a major debate in a major political contest, and that's saying something. I mean, I've been a journalist for 32 years now, have covered all kinds of elections and politics. I just have not been witness to anything quite like what we saw last night. But I want to hear what the two of you had to say. Karen, what was your impression?
I don't even know where to start. First of all, I wouldn't consider it a debate. I considered it a debacle. it was very disappointing, certainly from Trump's perspective, because, I mean, he creates his own narrative. I mean, he is a narcissist. It shows. Disappointing from the Biden side, because it appears that there is clear cognitive decline and compromise on his part, which, in anybody's opinion, would raise concern. I know, and I was following a lot of comments on Twitter. I guess they released a statement saying that Joe Biden had a cold because you couldn't hear him from the beginning. It sounded like his voice was somehow compromised. Mm-hmm. So from a presentation standpoint, Donald Trump appeared to be well prepped. He was not, he didn't stutter, he didn't seem to get too emotional, so from a presentation standpoint, he did well.
He seemed pretty sharp.
He did. I mean, an age notwithstanding, and in direct contrast to the presentation of Biden. Now, as you and Kerry were talking about substance, that's a whole different thing. Mm-hmm. AP did a very extensive analysis of the debate and talked about some exaggeration of facts on Biden's part, but Donald Trump just outright lies. It was more entertaining than it was informative.
Yeah. Osama, what did you think as you were watching last night?
Very disappointing.
Well,
very, very disappointing. And like you said, you know, your experience in the 32 years in this business. I have had 40 years of experience in this business. This is unbelievable. What we saw yesterday, it was a decline in the highest office in the land, a decline, and a very, very disappointing. And the world is laughing at us. is this what we can offer? Is that really what we can offer in this country? I mean, what happened to the country that has Bill Clinton and, you know, and Barack Obama? What happened? All of a sudden, you know, like we were watching like something that I could never, ever imagine in my life here, because what happened to the leadership in the Democratic Party? What happened to the leadership in the Republican Party? Why can't we offer something better, you know, especially at this time? Because This is a very trying time. America is on the decline. It's divided. It needs a leader to, you know, to grab us, to put us together, to show us where we can go forward on more issues today than ever. And what we saw yesterday, that a man that cannot say anything that makes sense to a man that says everything doesn't make sense and full of lies and exaggeration on both parts. You know, like I just could not imagine. First of all, I was shocked with Joe Biden. Totally shocked. I wasn't shocked with Donald Trump, because Donald Trump was Donald Trump.
He's been consistent, if nothing else, right?
Yeah, he was consistent, being arrogant, very, very offensive, and very insulting. And that's Donald Trump. So there was no surprise there. The surprise was in Joe Biden. So this morning and through the night, I can tell you frankly, I couldn't even take it because of the phone calls that I got from all around, you know, like from at least I did like probably about 7 interviews all night.
Yeah.
And people were very, very surprised. I mean, they thought that we are a better country than we are. And you're like, I don't know how to explain it. I'm just still right now in a shock. I expected something like this.
Yeah.
But not.
So I think the big question is, if you are a Democrat, is Joe Biden electable in November? Is a performance like this disqualifying because of the concerns that were already swirling about his cognition, about his alertness, about his focus? You know, does something like this change the calculus inside the party to say, maybe we have to do something else? And as a voter, does it mean that, you know, if you were on the fence, now you're saying, well, I can't do this.
But see, you think that you mentioned back in 2016 when Hillary Clinton took the Democratic vote for granted
in Michigan in particular.
Exactly.
Right?
And so you made some points about Donald Trump's personality and his character. Those are the things that his supporters find appealing. Mm. So from a Democratic standpoint, people are hardcore Democratic or Republican. They are, at least publicly. But privately, people are having reservations about whether or not Biden is capable of carrying out another 4-year term, which may present some reservation in the voting booth. That's going to be the calling, the difference, because Trump's people are going to show up.
Yes.
He has no problem turning them out. But then there are the backroom dynamics that people are talking about. Are they setting this up and setting Biden up for him not to complete a 4-year term so that Kamala Harris can assume a leadership position? I mean, there are all those conversations taking place. And I think Democrats, especially voters, are in general, because they're already experiencing such voter apathy, are just kind of sitting back and say, hey, maybe we're just going to let the cards fall where they may. Hmm. Or people may feel sympathetic and say, hey, you know, we really got to get in and secure this and show up. But I don't think that's going to happen.
Yeah. Osama, well, does this say that Joe Biden can't be the Democratic candidate in November?
Well, first of all, let's just look at what happened. Really, what happened is very strange, because first of all, Joe Biden is the presumptive nominee.
Mm-hmm.
The convention has not happened. Mm-hmm. He is not nominated. And the same thing is for Trump. 60 years ago, something like this happened.
Sure.
It never happened before. So why is it happening right now? I have a question. Why is it happening right now? I think that I do not want to go into conspiracy in here, but I really think that I think somebody set up something, because you wake up and you see the op-eds and you see the commentators on CNN, on MSNBC, you know, like, I don't want to talk about Fox, what they say, but you can see that there is a target there. The target is, oh, he really should bow out, you know, and the pressure right now is mounting on Biden to bow out. I believe so far that I have seen or heard until I walked in the studio this morning here, that none from the political, you know, who is who, mm-hmm. has done anything to say that Biden should bow out. But every commentator in the liberal, in the Democratic, from the left to the right, is saying, look, you know, that doesn't look good. The president should just bow out, open the door for something else.
I mean, and it can happen at the convention. I mean, we've seen that happen before.
And that's why it happened before the convention, right. Because I think it's set up.
So maybe that's why the debate was so much earlier than normal. Yeah, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, that's what I'm considering now. I'm not being conspiracy.
To give people a real look at
But really what happened yesterday, it seems like it was a setup. Like, whether it was intentionally or not intentionally, in order to change horse. Because I believe that the Democrats have internally been convinced that there is no way that Joe Biden can even finish this term. Not alone, just go for another four more years. And if he can beat Trump, because all the polls from all sources, from all walks, they showed clearly that Trump is beating him in all in most of the swing states, including Michigan. Now, some of the polls are very, very close. Other polls are just by 6-7 points, 8 points. But between now and November, I see more decline, you know, for Biden and even for Trump. Many people, especially the independent voters, are so disgusted.
Yeah.
They're not going to vote. They're not going to go out and vote.
Yeah.
And even someone, the Democrats, are not going to vote, and someone, the Republicans,
that's the real question.
You still have Robert Kennedy,
right?
I mean, he had his thing on Twitter last night. So I don't think that should be totally overlooked, especially if people want to participate in the process and are not feeling either of the two presumed candidates.
Yeah. Okay, we're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we are going to get into some of the meat of the debate between Joe Biden and Donald Trump last night, the things that they said, the things they said they will do, the kind of flubs that they had during the back and forth on stage in Atlanta. We also want to get going with you, the listeners, on the phones and on social. Give us a call and let us know what you made of the debate, the first debate of 2024 in the presidential cycle between Joe Biden and Donald Trump. Did it change your mind? Did you think that any of the performances would change your mind? This is the first time in I don't know how long that we're seeing a presidential debate in June before the conventions. Was that a good idea? Does that help you make a different kind of decision about how you want to vote? 313-577-1019 is the number here on the phones. That's 313-577-1019. You can also go to Twitter and hashtag Created Equal or at WDET. We'll be right back with more Created Equal. You You're listening to Created Equal from WDET in Detroit. I'm Stephen Henderson, and I'm really glad you've joined us for talking about last night's presidential debate between President Joe Biden and former President Donald Trump. We've got two great guests in the studio with us. Karen Dumas is a PR and communications consultant, someone I have talked about with politics for many, many years. Also, Osama Sablani is with us. He's the publisher of the Arab American News. We're talking about what the debate and what the presidential race kind of means and how it resonates here in Southeast Michigan, given the particular demographics of our region. Of course, Detroit is the largest majority African-American city in America. Democrats absolutely need Detroiters to turn out in November if they have any hope of winning the state of Michigan in the presidential contest. We're also home to one of the largest populations of Arab Americans in the world outside of the Middle East. And Democrats also are focused on that community, as are Republicans, because of what's going on in Israel and Gaza. We also want to hear from you, our listeners, about your reactions to the debate. It was, if again, I'm not sure that that's the right word for what we watched last night. Give us a sense of what it does to your thinking about the presidential contest. Were you going in with an open mind and came out with a decision? What did you think of the performances of the two candidates? What did you think of the substance of what both candidates said? Does that matter more in debates? Should it matter more in debates? 313-577-1019 is the number here on the phones. That's 313-577-1019. You can also go to Twitter and hashtag Created Equal or at WDET. Okay, I want to start this segment with some sound from last night's debate and get into some of the issues that we saw the two candidates discuss. This first clip is Donald Trump, the former president of the United States, talking about his agenda for African Americans and Latinos.
But when they see what I did for criminal justice reform and for the historically black colleges and universities where I funded them and got them all funded, and the opportunity zones with Tim, as you know, Tim Scott was incredible. He did a great job. Great senator from South Carolina. He came to me with the idea, and it was a great idea. It's one of the most successful economic development acts ever in the country, opportunity zones. And the biggest beneficiary are blacks. And that's why we have the best numbers with them in maybe ever. They're saying ever. I read this morning where ever the best numbers. He's lost much of the black population because he's done a horrible job for black people. He's also done a horrible job for Hispanics. But wait till you see these millions of people pouring into our country, and they're going to take the jobs, and it's already started, and you haven't seen anything yet. It's a disaster.
It's a disaster, he says, that immigrants to this country, whether they're legal or illegal, are somehow taking jobs. And he talked about black jobs at some point as well during the debate.
Which is said at an amazing conversation on Twitter.
You got to love black Twitter. It is always going to take whatever happens and make it really entertaining.
And that is the man who just few weeks ago said that immigrants poisoning Americans' blood.
Yeah.
That's the same man.
Yeah.
who was making all these good claims. Like he said immigrants poison American blood.
So this is a theme that we hear a lot in presidential politics, which is how do you respond to the crisis of immigration in this country? And I mean that in the grandest terms. I mean, the people who are trying to come here to be Americans are in as much of that crisis as our sensibilities about who should be an American or not. But this idea that the people who want to be Americans are somehow taking from those of us who are, and in particular taking from African Americans, it's a wedge issue that that I think has particular resonance in places like Detroit, Karen.
Well, you know, that was kind of it was quietly a very discriminating or racist comment when he said that, because what the interpretation of that is that there are people that are coming here that are willing to do jobs that perhaps African Americans have not traditionally been willing to do. So that's because that's what people say. You know, you can have, you know, an immigrant coming in and, you know, they'll do the hard work, the dirty work, and the whole nine yards. The bigger question is, and this is a question that's always asked in every election, are you better off? Who were you better off under in terms of whether it was Trump, whether it was Biden? What have they done? What could they do? A lot of promises get lost in the fact that, you know, there is an executive, legislative, and judicial branch of government all that weigh in on the decisions and the impact and the potential execution of the promises that are made. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I was talking in the lobby before I came in. Black people are still asking for the same things that they've been asking for over 50 years. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's been the needle has moved very little, maybe one, two people, you know. So collectively, as a people, we're still experiencing the same challenges that you have. So everybody carts out their black supporters and their black agenda during an election, and then that agenda is put back in the drawer after the election, and the results are never there.
But here we're talking about a president who in 4 years has lowered the black unemployment rate beyond what anybody expects.
But Stephen, some of those people are working two and three.
They are,
you
no
know,
question.
Low income positions.
But and child poverty right now is at an all time low. I keep repeating that. I mean, I don't think that's gotten nearly the coverage that it should. At the same time, this is a president who hasn't delivered on the Voting Rights Act extension that has been sitting in Congress for quite some time. He can't deliver on the George Floyd Policing Act. I mean, it's a balance. But overall, would you say African Americans are not better off for Joe Biden having been president?
I would say no. I don't think so. I don't see the type of progress that I think this country is capable of delivering under anybody. I really don't. But let me also say this. It's not necessarily because of policy as much as it is because of personal practice. You can have, you know, you had after George Floyd, you had everybody stood up, even here downtown. We've got the DEI and the whole nine yards. But Stephen, if you and I are sitting across the table and I'm interviewing you and I don't want to hire you because of something, some prejudicial perspective that I have, I can circumvent a policy and my personal practice will still prevent you from receiving that job, that promotion, that benefit. I mean, we can talk about the racial tension that to me still exists not only in this country, but right here in this city.
Yeah.
So, no, I don't. And it's not just him. I mean, I didn't see it under Obama. Everybody was just playing nice under Obama. And then Trump gave them permission to be whomever they were. So, no.
Well, first of all, I think that Donald Trump doesn't care about African Americans. He really
who does?
and he doesn't care about white Americans. And he doesn't care about America, you know. He is playing politics. He is trying to appeal because he believes that an African American votes for Biden, he has to get at least 80 to 90% of the votes so he can win because this is what every statistic, and he is looking at these statistics and saying, how could I take these numbers down for Biden? And he is making all these allegations. Now, I'm not defending Biden. Biden is guilty as charged, maybe, but he is not saying it because he believes that he can do better. He believes that he can use this in order to bring down the numbers.
So you think it's not even about getting African Americans to vote for him? It's just about getting him to sit home,
or maybe vote for him because he continues to make to spread. You know, like look, he's approaching Arab Americans. You know what he's saying? I've met with some of his you know advisors, and Tuesday I had a 1 hour discussion with one of his top advisors.
Mm-hmm.
Punish Biden, vote for me. I mean, that's how silly the discussion is.
Right. Like, it's not like, that like, well, I will deliver for you.
We punished you. We voted for Biden. Look what we got.
Yeah.
in 2020.
So, Osama, what do you make of this use of immigration, though, as a way to frighten African Americans or Latinos who are already here in the country? I mean, there's something particularly pernicious, I think, about that, and it's damaging to the relationships that we need to have in communities like Southeast Michigan.
Well, first of all, we're a nation of immigrants, okay? So this is who we are. We are a nation of immigrants. So immigration has been really a problem for decades. I remember when I came in 1976 to the United States, the country that I came to, it's not the same country that I'm living in. I can tell you when I got my green card, in 1978, it took probably maybe 20, 25 minutes to get it. But from the time I walked into the Mount Elliott office to the time that I got out with my passport stamped with an A number, you know, and then they told me that I will get it in 4 weeks. I got it in 2 weeks.
Wow.
The green card. Do you know how long it's taken right now my sister to get her green card? 12 years.
Wow.
12 years. So it's not the same country, and it's not a Democrat, a Republican. It's a disease in our political system we are not able to get rid of. And I think that this is the biggest issue that we have to face. It's not a Republican. It's not a Democrat. It's an American problem. Mm-hmm. Immigration. Yes, we have illegal immigrants, and we should not have illegal immigrants because it's not safe. But we have to open immigration so people can walk in.
We've got to make it easier for people to come here.
But I was going to say, you just hit the nail on the head, because on the podcast that I do with Charlie LaDuff, we've talked to Border Patrol. We've talked to people that are down there. Mm-hmm. And it's just a lack of process. I mean, so, you know, you've got to be able to do it. But in this country, we add layers of process on top of progress, on top of process, and they impede progress. Right. Like, you know, and it just becomes a long, cumbersome thing that never results in what it's supposed to do.
They do not want to resolve it, whether the Democrats or the Republicans. They do not want to take an issue like immigration, because it's a very sensitive issue. It's an issue that affects the votes in the ballot. That's why they stay away from it. But it is a problem in our country, and they should approach it in a way to open it up.
I want to play a little more sound here from last night's debate, and this is, I think, really relevant to what we're talking about right now. This is Trump's characterization of Joe Biden during an exchange about what's happening in the Middle East, in Israel and Gaza right now.
You got to ask him, as far as Israel and Hamas, Israel's the one that wants to go. He said the only one that wants to keep going is Hamas. Actually, Israel is the one, and you should let him go and let him finish the job. He doesn't want to do it. He's become like a Palestinian, but they don't like him because he's a very bad Palestinian. He's a weak one.
So what jumped out to me about that little passage there is the way he uses the word Palestinian. He's using it as an insult to President Biden. He's a Palestinian, and he says they don't even like him. He's a weak one. Osama, I'm really curious about how that lands on your ears.
Well, I think Biden is a weak president. I really do. I think if it was Ronald Reagan, if it was Bill Clinton, the situation in Gaza would not have deteriorated to that level.
You think they would have done more?
I think they should. The United States have the power to stop it, but you have to exercise the power. You have to have a president that can say, look, stop it. And he was never serious. I met with his advisors. I met with his campaign manager, national campaign manager. I met with the White House delegation. I met with his private in, you know, ambassadors in here and advisors that they came to my office. We sat down and talked. They are not serious about stopping this war. He is not a strong president. I don't know if he's insulting him, but I think both of them are worse than each other when it comes. Like, Biden has political experience. Trump does not have the experience.
Yeah.
And when you talk to Trump, you know what scares me most about Trump? It's what he will do to America, not what we'll do outside.
Mm.
Because he does not want our country to have institutions, what makes our country great. He wants to destroy the institutions and make it one of his corporations. He can hire and fire as well. He wants to be Putin in America. Mm. He wants to be Kim Jong-un, you know, of America. He does not want to be a president for 4 years. You know, he wants to build a kingdom. He wants to make an America USA Inc.
Yeah,
as one of his companies. That's what he wants.
So
that's what scares me the most.
I have to say, though, that when he says he's a Palestinian, and the way he says in the tone that he used, and then the language he kind of wraps that in, it's a denigration of the idea of being Arab American, right?
Of course. But what do you expect out of Trump?
I was going to say, isn't that classic Trump, though? I mean.
But listen, let me just make one more point. You have seen how many people work for Trump in 4 years of his term. Give me one that still respect Trump or like Trump or support Trump. And that shows you what kind of person is Trump. So I'm not really surprised. He's insulting Arabs. And he insulted the king of Saudi Arabia, who is an ally, you know, in one of his speeches. The man does not respect anybody. He doesn't even respect his wife what he has done with whatever her name is.
Right. All the things that came out in that trial. Okay, we're going to take another quick break, and when we come back, we're going to get to your phone calls and social media comments. If you want to join us, 313-577-1019 is the number. Call and tell us what you made of the presidential debate last night, what you make of the presidential race. What do you think is going to happen here in Southeast Michigan, a key part of the state, in a key state in the whole presidential contest? 313-577-1019 is the number here on the phones. That's 313-577-1019. You can also go to Twitter and hashtag created equal or at WDET. We'll be right back with more Created Equal. We are back with more Created Equal from WDET in Detroit. I'm Stephen Henderson, and we're talking about last night's presidential debate, the first maybe of several debates that we'll have. I'm not sure that anybody has an appetite for more after what we saw on stage in Atlanta last night. We're talking with Karen Dumas. She's a PR and communications consultant, someone I talk to an awful lot about politics here in Michigan and Detroit. Also with us is Osama Siblani. He's the publisher of the Arab American News. We're talking about what this debate means in our community, a place where the African-American vote and turnout really matters, can matter tremendously in presidential contests, where we also have a very large Arab-American population whose votes are also highly sought after by both parties. We want to hear from you, our listeners, on the phones and on social. 313-577-1019 is the number. That's 313-577-1019. You can also go to Twitter and hashtag Detroit or hashtag Created Equal or at WDET. Let's start today with Diane in Birmingham. Diane, welcome to the show.
Hi, good morning.
Hi. Go ahead.
So last night I missed the first couple minutes of the debate and had to go back and watch it later. So I saw the later part of the debate. I was very surprised when I saw those first couple of minutes, and I had to ask myself, why was he so different at the beginning than he was later on? And what I realized is that Joe Biden is a father and he's a family man, and the most important thing in his whole world is his family. And for the first time, he had to stand feet away from Donald Trump, who has decimated and publicly humiliated and tortured his son, Hunter. I know Hunter has done things that are wrong. I understand that. But for a human being and a father to have to face in person somebody who has done so much abuse towards our own child, and especially somebody who has done so much wrong himself, I don't know how anyone could have formulated ideas.
So, Diane, you feel like that explains the lack of focus, the hesitancy, the errors that Joe Biden was making in his responses last night?
In the beginning. I mean, we have there are nuances. So we have other elements. We do have his age. I would never vote for Trump. I just a little background. I served in Peace Corps in Ukraine. I have spent 3 years sending food, doing a food program in Ukraine, sending medical supplies to Ukraine. I saw Ukrainians when they first gained their freedom. I saw them singing in the streets their national songs for the first time in their lifetime without worry of repercussion. They are the kindest people I have ever come in contact with. Mm-hmm. And so that's an aside.
So, but Diane, let me ask you this. Are you going to – did the debate make it easier or harder for you to vote for Joe Biden in November?
It made it harder. Yeah. It made it harder. Yeah. I mean, you've got on one hand somebody whose only motivation is himself. He'll say whatever he needs to say to get votes and to get people to like him. Most of the time, what he's saying is not true. He donated to black colleges because a campaign person told him, this is how you're going to get the black vote.
Yeah.
He didn't do it because he cares about people. And this is a person who has lied. I have an elderly mother who is telling me that there were no guns on January 6th and that people were just at the Capitol to tour as tourists. So she has received so much propaganda.
She believes what he says. Yeah.
I have no...
Dan, I really appreciate the call and that perspective. I mean, I think there's a lot of people this morning who are feeling very much the same way. Let's go next to Khalif in Detroit. Khalif, what's on your mind?
Hey, how you guys doing today?
Good, how are you?
Yeah, good. A couple of things. One, I think today on this date in the United States history, the Democrats are at a pivotal moment because they're going to have to make a bold move to win this thing. Because after last night's showing, it's tough out there, you know. In terms of Joe Biden, I mean, his legacy could very well be the guy who sank the ship, because he didn't want to pass the mantle on to a younger generation of Democrats.
Mm.
And if that ego is a hell of a drug, they say, and he needs to really, you know, some people really need to get to him and just, you know, they have to make a bold move to win. Because last night's showing, my mother is 90 years old, and Karen Dumas knows my mother. She has so much more fire than what Biden showed on the stage last night.
So Khalif, I'm curious about your own personal decisions here. Did the debate last night make it harder for you to show up in November and vote for Joe Biden? Or are you thinking, well, this is just kind of a chapter in a bigger book about what's going on and the things that the president has done over the last 4 years? Are what I'm really thinking about when I cast my vote. I'm curious about what your thinking is.
And last night was, for me personally, was just confirmation that Joe Biden is cooked. Period. that's what it was.
Ouch.
Straight with no chaser. You know,
cooked.
Yeah, cooked. Done. Yeah. Done.
Yeah.
And it's unfortunate. And I'm, you know, and I had made some posts a week ago that I just cannot believe in this day and age that the Democratic Party didn't groom anyone or take the time to even look at anyone
as
know, my man is, you know, he's getting up there in age, and it showed last night, and you guys did not even have anybody waiting in the wings. That's just terrible.
Yeah.
And so Khalif, they get what they deserve.
Khalif, I really appreciate your call and that perspective. Again, I think you're echoing what a lot of people are feeling today. Let's go next to Jim in Charleston, South Carolina. Jim, welcome to the show.
Hey, good morning, Stephen.
Hey.
Good morning, Stephen. I'll try to be succinct. You know, the media really can only focus on Trump's actual or potential incorrect statements. And, you know, like at this point, that's nothing new. Biden completely reinforced everyone's worst perceptions and expectations of him. I mean, most of the time he was so incoherent that it would be difficult to evaluate his statements. And the thing that scares me is this is the leader of the free world. It makes me wonder who's running the executive branch. So like 6 months ago, I predicted, I said to friends, the Democratic Party has a very narrow lane. They know he probably can't make four more years. I don't think they want Vice President Harris in the presidency. So like at the convention now, here comes Newsom, here comes somebody else. So I just think it's interesting.
So you think...
My final thing is for Karen and Khalif. I care deeply about Black Detroiters, Arab Detroiters, and Hispanic Detroiters.
So Jim, you feel like is your theory that at the convention the president will step away and not accept the nomination?
I think there's a lane now that's clearly open for him to gracefully do that and just say he doesn't have four more years in him and it's time for new leadership.
Yeah.
And
I have been talking about that for months. And, when he announced last year, I thought to myself that that was what was going on. He was unwilling to kind of leave things to a bitter primary, and he doesn't have a vice president who has kind of a consensus backing that he would ride this out through the convention and then let the floor decide, at the convention. I'm not the only person who's forwarded that theory. Lots of people are thinking about it, I think, today as well. I really appreciate the call, though, in that perspective. Let's go to Adam in Macomb. Adam, welcome to the show.
Hey,
go ahead.
Morning, sir.
Uh-huh.
I wanted to, I moved to this country when I was 10 from Egypt, and I just wanted to comment on both candidates and just my stance as an Arab American, how I'm going to move forward. I wasn't confident that either one of them were holding Israel to the bar that should be set for a nation invading another nation.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it makes me deeply uncomfortable to have that weight on my shoulders to vote for either one.
Mm.
I think that's a sentiment that's shared with a lot of my family and a lot of people in my community as well.
So then what are you going to do, Adam? I mean, someone's going to be president after the election in November. If you don't vote, then you don't have any say in it.
This is true. But hopefully the say of not choosing either evil will be louder than picking one that you sort of agree with. I think.
Well, Adam, I love that you called and shared that. And again, I think the community that you come from is hurting a lot right now anyway. And this kind of makes it worse. Okay, we've got about a minute left. I'm going to ask Karen and Osama what happens. What happens in the next couple of weeks? Does Joe Biden stay as the nominee?
Well, I think today is going to be telling because he's campaigning today. So let's see if him on the campaign trail today is a reflection of his demeanor that he had last night at the debate. And
if he's sharper.
That's what I'm saying. Or just how do they, you can't spin this. So let's just see what happens from here on out. You indicated earlier, there are conversations that are being taken place in the dark room, in the back room, in terms of planning and strategy. All of this is very deliberate and strategic, and we only see the outcomes of it. So I think voters would be best to just pay attention, to be engaged, and whomever you decide would be a better candidate, whether it is Biden, Trump, or different nominees, you got to get up and get behind them.
Yeah, yeah. Osama, we got about 30 seconds here.
Well, I cannot fill the bubble for either one of them.
You can't vote for one of these guys.
I cannot. I believe Adam articulated my position and my community's position. There is no way that we can vote for Biden. He killed. He is a partner in the crime of killing 37,000 Palestinian, mostly children and women. We cannot vote for Trump because he's going to destroy our country, and he is not stable person, and therefore I blame the both parties not able to present the American people someone
with a better
who
choice
we can vote for.
I think we gotta hold our breath on that though, because I'm not sure that these are going to be the candidates on the ballot in November. We'll see though. Osama Ciblani and Karen Dumas, always great to talk with
both of you.
Thanks for coming. Remember, you can listen to recent episodes of Created Equal at WDET.org, and we would love if you would subscribe to our podcast. Created Equal is produced by Kerry Jr. II and David Lines. Audio editing is by Connor Anderson, and the music is by Sam Bobian. Created Equal is a production of WDET, a listener-supported service of Wayne State University. This is WDET-FM, Detroit Public Radio, your connection to news, music, and conversation.